Well, good morning, everyone, and can I welcome members to the ninth meeting in 2017 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. Apologies have been received this morning from Stuart McMillan, but we welcome George Adam in his place, and we're grateful to you for coming, George. Thank you. Moving to agenda item one, which is instruments subject to negative procedure, and no points have been raised by our legal advisers on non-domestic rating valuation of utilities Scotland Amendment Order 2017 SSI 2017 number 42, or on the Act of Sederunt Fees of Solicitors in the Court of Session and Sheriff Court Amendment Pursuer's Office 2017 SSI 2017 number 53, or on the Shellfish Restrictions on Taking by Unlicensed Fishing Boats, Scotland, Order 2017, SSI 2017, number 57, or on the Personal Injuries NHS Charges Amounts, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2017, SSI 2017, number 58, or on National Health Service Payments and Remission of Charges Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2017. SSI 2017 number 59, or on the non-domestic rates renewable energy generation relief Scotland Amendment Regulations 2017 SSI 2017 number 60. So is the committee content with these instruments? Thank you. Which takes us to agenda item two, which is instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. And again, no points have been raised by our legal advisers on the final instrument before us today, which is the Act of Sederunt Rules of the Court of Session 1994 and Ordinary Cause Rules 1993 Amendment Pursuers Offers 2017 SSI 2017 number 52. So is the committee also content with this instrument? Many thanks. We now move to agenda item three, which is the Contract Third Party Rights Scotland Bill. And this item in the agenda is the consideration of evidence on the Contract Third Party Rights Scotland Bill at stage one, and this is our first evidence session on the bill. So it's my great pleasure this morning to welcome Graham Crombie and Hector MacQueen from the Scottish Law Commission, and Katrina Marshall and Jill Clark from the Scottish Government. Welcome to our committee. And we will now move, if we may, to questions from our committee. And if I can just identify where I put the questions, I will ask the first one, which is to you all, to discuss common law to statutory footing. And in general terms, what is the rationale for moving from a common law position to a statutory footing in this bill?
If I start, I think the Scottish Law Commission's submission of written evidence to the committee helpfully sets out the benefits of the move from the common law to placing the law on a statutory footing. And I'm sure Professor MacQueen will be able to elaborate on that. We did, of course, consider this issue ahead of settling on our preferred policy approach. And it seemed to us that the law is uncertain and is not fit for purpose at the moment because it has been left to develop in this way. So court decisions have resulted in a reluctance to use the existing law. And in turn, this means that there's very little, if any, opportunity for the courts to resolve the current issues with the law. So that's why in our policy memorandum, when we considered alternative approaches, we thought probably the only alternative was to leave the courts to improve the law through judicial reform. But the outcome of that could not be guaranteed. And on past experience, it could take a very, very long time for it to actually reform the law in this way. So placing the law on a statutory footing seemed the only effective way of making the necessary reforms.
Anyone else got anything they'd like to add on that? Professor MacQueen?
Well, I think the main thing that one can say is that common law is based on the judge's decisions, and the judge's decisions depend on someone putting a question to them for a decision. And occasionally judges don't get things absolutely right, and in this particular instance that happened in 1920 in the House of Lords. But it sometimes takes time to realise where and how it is wrong. And I think if you look back at the history of it, people certainly realised by the immediate post-war period that this decision was unhelpful, but it has, in modern commercial conditions, current commercial conditions, become particularly obviously unsuitable as a basis for legal development here. And the problem is that you would have to go all the way to the top of the judicial tree, i.e. the Supreme Court. And in order to do that, you've got to find a litigant who's prepared to pay, because the litigant who loses pays for everything. So understandably, I think solicitors and their advocates are very reluctant to advise their clients to take a chance on these things unless it's absolutely cast iron guaranteed result. So legislation is, I think, the only way in which you can actually meet the difficulties that exist right now. We might get a case in 100 years that meets the difficulties of the 22nd century, but meanwhile, the people of the 21st will just have to struggle on unless we pass this legislation. So I think that's the major reason for shifting from common law to statute in this area. It has to be said that in many ways, the statute expresses what is the existing common law, just with this particular wrinkle from 1920 removed and ironed out.
Would you be kind enough just to cite the particular case to read it into the record so that
yes,
we can see the basis on which we are proceeding and the reasons why?
Right. The case in question is called Carmichael against Carmichael's Executrix, and it's in the 1920 session cases, House of Lords, and up to this point I'm confident, but I think it's page 191. 195, sorry.
Excellent. Page 195, where yep. It's found wanting.
Yes.
Right. And when you said it became apparent in the post-war era, I presume you meant the Second World War.
Yes.
Notwithstanding the fact that this was
in 1920. I think that's right. And the case in question actually arose out of an air accident in the First World War, which is an interesting story in itself, but it's not relevant to today's proceedings.
Okay. Right, is there anything else anyone else would like to contribute to the initial question before we move on to further questioning? Thank you very much for clearly defining that then. Now move to Alison Harris, who's got two or three questions.
Good morning. You know, I appreciate that there are current areas of uncertainty about the scope of the law, but could you maybe explain what is the level of uncertainty in the current law?
I think I will defer to Hector probably a fair bit on this, but there are quite a few areas. I mean, Hector's already mentioned that a lot of the bill actually restates what people think the law is just now, but the think is probably the uncertain bit. So we think that you can have third-party rights for someone perhaps who isn't in existence at the moment. They've yet to be born, or the company is yet to be formed, but that's not absolutely certain. And it's those uncertainties and similar ones that the bill is addressing. And then it's also rectifying the issue about irrevocability, which is the main difficulty with the current law that makes it the most problematic, I think. Hector, do you?
Yeah, I mean, the other sort of aspect of the common law, as I said earlier, is that if you don't get a judicial decision, you don't necessarily get an absolutely clear rule. So quite a number of the sections, particularly the remedies and defences parts, are there because they answer questions which have been asked in writings on the subject, but never answered because no case presenting the question squarely has come before the the courts. So one of the problems with the common law is there are gaps. And you can say, well, in principle, it ought to be this. But having a legal rule stated in statute creates obviously much more certainty. And on one or two aspects, notably the defences, we cast it in slightly narrower terms than most of the books did. We talk about how the defence must be relevant to the third party right. And in our written paper, we give the example of the case, is it example one in our numbered sets of examples in the written evidence, where the contract from which the third party right sprang was illegal at the particular time, wouldn't be now. It was illegal, but the illegality in question did not apply to the third party rights. There was nothing illegal about giving benefits to members of, to the families, I beg your pardon, of the members of this particular association. So it's example two. Thank you again, Graham. I'm not doing too well in my numbers this morning.
That's all right.
But the that's the sort of thing that you need a case raising the issue directly to get it clearly resolved. And this is what we have tried to provide, a clear and certain rule on this particular point.
Okay. Well, thank you for that answer. But do you know what, just in order to help me further, you know, could you maybe expand on some specific areas of uncertainty? I know you did mention remedies, but I was thinking about what remedies are available to third parties in the current law. You mentioned defences, but, you know, to which or to what degree, you know, for defences, well, what is there for carrying out a contract such as error and misrepresentation? How does that apply to third-party rights?
Yeah.
And the third thing that comes to mind is the time limits for bringing a claim under third-party rights. Could you expand on that for me, please?
Yeah, sure. The shall I take the remedies point first?
Please,
the uncertainty, the very specific uncertainty, is about whether a third party can claim damages if the performance that is rendered to that third party is defective in some way. There's been almost no case law actually raising that point. And in principle, it should be clear that the third party does indeed have such a right. But text writers have cast doubt on it thanks to various 19th century cases, which they say are relevant. Others say, myself included, they are not relevant, but there's that degree of dispute and doubt as to what the law is, and hence the wish to be clear and to give what is basically a principled answer. If I breach my contract with you, you are entitled to damages. Likewise, if you were a third party to a contract between Graham and me, you would be entitled to damages if our performance was not up to the level you reasonably expected from the way in which we'd expressed your third-party right. So that's the remedies thing. When you talk about error and misrepresentation, that is where you start getting into the possible defences that would be available. Now, the question of error and misrepresentation would start, I think, as between the two contracting parties. And one of them, in entering the contract, might make a representation to the other, which brings the other into the contract, and that representation turns out to be untrue. And that's a misrepresentation, and there's an error on the part of the person who is, so to speak, the victim. Now, in law, in general law of contract, that would make the contract void or voidable. Again, some degree of uncertainty in that particular area. Question, for the third-party right which springs from that contract, is it exactly void or voidable in the same way as the main contract? Does the voidness of the main contract impact on the third party? And I think in general the answer is probably yes, but what we need is a clear position that says the misrepresentation impacts as much on the third party right as it does on the basic contract, as between the original contracting parties. And it may well be that it doesn't apply. The third party knows nothing of any misrepresentation. The third party is merely receiving a benefit, and the misrepresentation was not about the third party right in the first place. So why should it affect the third party right? If that's what the parties, contracted parties, intended, then the third party right is really independent, if you will, of the contract in that sort of sense. So what we are saying in the provision on defence is tries to allow for that kind of analysis to be made by the courts. And then the time limit thing, I think that must be section, is it 11 or 12 of the bill? Section 11, yeah, the prescription. What we noticed in the course of our work was that the Prescription and Limitation Act 1973 has a long list of the obligations to which its prescriptive period applies, but there is no specific mention of third-party rights. And we could see that was a possible gap, that somewhere some clever lawyer might say, well, there's no prescription in relation to a third party's right. The third party can claim any time indefinitely into the future. And again, in principle, we didn't think that was correct. The correct principle is that 5 years, basically, is the period that a party has got to bring a claim. So the provision in Section 11 is to make it clear. And it also has this slightly retrospective element, because we want it to be clear for the law as it has been as well in this particular area. So these are the sorts of specifics, if you like, of the unclarity. And it's often about what the law as yet does not say, but now will say, that we are driving at here.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor MacQueen. Anyone else want to contribute to those questions? Right. Thank you very much. I'll now move to a colleague, David Torrance, who's got a few questions, please. David.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, everybody. I'd like to focus on the irrevocability rule. Can you expand on the problems with the current irrevocability rule and why it would be useful for contacts granting third-party rights to be cancelled or modified?
I mean, again, I think Hector will have more to say on this, but I mean, the case that Hector spoke about, the Carmichael case, that kind of set the bar, which said, you know, once you've given someone a third party right, you cannot take it away, you cannot cancel it, you cannot modify it. And that seems to be a complete nonsense when you think that the two main parties to a contract can obviously at any time decide to cancel or modify their obligations, but you can't do it with a third party. And so that has created a significant inflexibility in the law, and that is the thing that I think most people shy away from our existing law on third-party rights because of their concerns about that. And it just doesn't allow the flexibility that you need in today's kind of commercial legal transactions or indeed personal legal transactions. Hector?
Yes, I mean, I think that's the essential key. What we received from the legal profession that led us into investigating this topic in the Commission was a message that the jus quaesitum tertio was perceived as inflexible because of the irrevocability rule. You had created a right which you couldn't change, and this was unacceptable, particularly from a commercial point of view, because obviously circumstances change, things move on, and you may want to cancel the right altogether. More typically, perhaps, you might want to adjust it slightly in order to meet new circumstances, less resource available. It's even conceivable you might want to modify it in favour of the third party and increase the benefit that it's going to get. But you can't do that if you've created an effective third-party right. At least you can't do it without the third party's consent, which will not necessarily be forthcoming without cost, shall we say. So we're trying to create a regime which is flexible instead of inflexible, but which nonetheless lets the third party's right crystallise at certain points in time so that they cannot any longer at that point be changed. And that's essentially what sections 4 to 6 do. They set out the circumstances in which the third party right crystallises and can no longer be changed. So what we're really trying to do is remove irrevocability as a precondition and instead make it a consequence of the agreement plus certain other things having happened in three different sets of circumstances set out in sections 4 to 6 of the bill.
Thank you for that. Do you think the bill provides the right balance between the rights of the contracting parties to change their minds and the rights of the third parties?
I think it does. I think it's the starting point has to be that it's the contracting parties who create the situation in the first place. And I think it's not unreasonable, shall we say, to allow them to remain in control of it up to the points which are set down in sections 4 to 6. So if they make their third-party right conditional on something, as in example 2 in our written evidence, well, when that condition is fulfilled and the third-party right hasn't been changed anyway, then it's enforceable. That seems fairly straightforward. The section 5 deals with the situation where the third party right is either unconditional, i.e. it could be enforced immediately, or it's what we call technically future. It's to take place, payment, let's say, is to take place on a date in the future. And we'll have to wait until the 30th of March, and then the right's enforceable. But if the contracting parties notify the third party at that today that right will exist and be enforceable on the 31st of March, then, again, they can't change their mind. And why should they be able to change their mind? They've notified this person, they've made this person think, I'm going to get that right, or payment, or whatever it is, on the 30th of March. And then the final one, and the longest one, is where you have a right that may be conditional. In some sense, it's going forward into the future. But the third party, as we put it, relies, or if another way of putting it might be to change its position on the basis, well, I'm going to get this third party right eventually. And what we would say there to start with is, of course, that the third party isn't entitled to rely because this right is not yet fulfilled. The conditions on which it comes into existence are not going to yet be fulfilled. But if the third party's reliance is known to the contracting parties, and they don't stop it, they acquiesce in the technical language of the law, or if the reliance is reasonably foreseeable, despite its the right's conditionality, then that right becomes irrevocable, provided that there was reliance, which was damaging to the third party, and if the contract is now cancelled or changed, there will be further damage to the third party. Now, we try to give an instance of that in our example 6, thank you, with our dear daughter Tara, who is being paid for in her expensive course in the United States by the firm of partners of which her parent is a member. And what we're trying to use that example to show is, first of all, there is the reliance before the cancellation. She spends money flying to the United States. Okay? The partners want to cancel the right, or because the firm is no longer making, as they see it, enough money. If they are allowed to pull out, not only will she have, as it were, wasted her money in flying over to the States, but she'll also lose out on the opportunity of completing her degree study in the United States. So there'll be an adverse consequence, as the bill puts it, going on afterwards. So it's a twin-headed thing. It's quite a tough test to pass. We've borrowed it from other legislation on which there's been relatively little case law over the last 20 years, either because the statute is wonderfully clear and so no one needs to get into dispute, or because the hurdle is actually quite high for the party who has relied to actually cross and get a successful claim in. I personally think it's more the former, because although it's quite long, it is actually quite clear if you take it step by step and work your way through the requirements. So we do provide for third-party protection in circumstances where it was clearly fairer to the third party to say, yes, you now have an irrevocable right. And before that time, we give the contracting parties freedom to change the situation to meet their own requirements first. So I'm content that we've got a balance.
Thank you for that answer. Going back to Sections 4 and 6, could you explain in more detail how the exceptions in Section 4 and 6 of the Bill will stop the contracting parties modifying or cancelling a third-party right will operate in the practice?
Well, I think, we've given some examples in the written evidence. I think perhaps the particularly good one for Section 4 is the example 2. Now, this is a nice illustration of a conditional third-party right, which is what Section 4 is intended to apply to. Run you through the example. You've got the professional association formed by contract. It was really, at the time this case was decided, in effect a trade union. That's where the illegality came from under the law as it stood at the time of this particular case that I mentioned earlier. Now, what the contract between the members says that the association will provide benefits to the families of members who become unable to work through death or illness. I think in the original case, they referred to insanity. I don't think we would do that today. But that was, in fact, what happened. The member in this particular case became insane or fell insane. And his spouse claimed the benefits provided for in the contract. Now, the point there for Section 4, this is an example of a conditional obligation. Third party has no rights until a certain event occurs. That is the death, illness of the member to whom she happened to be married. The right crystallises at that point. She's entitled to it. Even though the rules of the association allowed the association to change the rules, you know, because it's an association of members, it's a voluntary association, they can change the rules that apply. But they couldn't change the rule in relation to the particular person, the particular family member who was making the claim at a time when the rules hadn't been changed. Okay, so she gets the benefit. The association may think, oh my goodness, this is actually very expensive. We'd better change the rules so that we give them a little bit less. Or it might say, this is absolutely miserable. We might ought to change the rules to give them more. Or whatever. They could do whatever they liked. But so far as this particular individual, this particular pursuer was concerned, they were committed. She had an irrevocable right at that point. And we think that's the correct analysis of that particular fact scenario. So that's Section 4. I mean, would you like me to give another example?
That should be sufficient. Thank you.
Right, OK. And I think I gave the example already for Section 6 with the lovely Tara in example 6 in the handout, which tries to take you through the different stages of reliance by the third party that will produce the effect that, in fairness, she ought to be allowed this right, even though the conditions of it are not yet completely fulfilled.
Thank you.
OK. right, moving. You finished, David. Thank you very much. Practical problems for the current law. Monica, if you'd like to give that a blast, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I think in your answer to the first question, you helpfully set out the rationale for this and that the current situation isn't fit for purpose. So in the policy memorandum, you've indicated that the legislation will promote the use of Scots law. And I think you've touched on that earlier, that your investigation shows that lawyers in Scotland are applying English law to Scottish contracts. Do you have any sort of feel for the extent to which that is happening? Are you able to quantify it in any way?
I don't think we can quantify it. I think there's a lot of anecdotal evidence, and there's been a lot of articles written recently about third-party rights because of where we are with the report and the bill, and they all refer to the 1999 Act in England and Wales being used instead as a kind of workaround. So we think that it's probably used quite regularly, but we couldn't actually quantify it. And that's one of the workarounds, I think, at the moment. The other is, in certain sectors to use something called collateral warranties. So the law doesn't work as it stands, so Scots lawyers are looking at ways of, other ways of making things fit for their purpose.
Okay, I wonder then, can you maybe explain a bit further why that is a negative consequence, why these workarounds and why applying English law is a negative?
Well, because we'd want our Scots law to be fit for purpose and to be used. And we want it to be used in the courts. We want it to facilitate transactions. We don't want it to be a hindrance to people that they have to, if you've trained in Scots law, I suppose the last thing you want to do is go and have to apply a different jurisdiction's law to something that is an essentially Scottish transaction. I don't know, Hector, if you've got more to add to that.
It's certainly not anything against use of English law, or indeed English law generally. It's more a case, really, of, I think, if Scots law is not doing the job, it's really up to Scottish lawyers, Scottish Parliament, the Scottish courts, where possible, to do something about it. And I think if one leaves law in a state that nobody uses it, there's something amiss. This is just part of the mechanics of society, if you like. And people will remain free to use English law if they prefer it, and they may do so. But it's a pity if the legal system isn't working for those who work and live in it. One of my colleagues in the Commission a few years ago gave a useful metaphor, I think, which is, this is like the plumbing. This is the world we live in. This is a society, this is the country we live in. We have a legal system which is different. But it's not necessarily the best legal system in the world, and there are some bits of it that aren't working so well. And so just as you wouldn't leave deficiencies in your plumbing for too long, at least, once you knew about them, so you adjust the legal system in order to meet the requirements of today. And I mean, fitness for purpose is a bit of a cliche, but it is actually a very important point for a legal system. It ought to work for those who are living under it.
I just wanted to get a sense that, are people missing out because of the current limitations? And also for the legal profession, are there practical difficulties in terms of being able to apply the law if the Scottish law is inadequate and you're having to apply English law? Does that present difficulties for the profession?
Solicitors are always very good at finding solutions, workarounds. And I think, to me, the major thing in this is that if you've got a client who is sufficiently well healed to be able to afford the Rolls-Royce service, then the solicitors will produce results that work, and they will bear liability for that, sometimes of very large sums indeed. My concern in some ways is more with the kind of people who can't afford that sort of bespoke service. And to my way of thinking, it's rather important that the law in its sort of default mode, which we talk about a bit in our written evidence on page one, should give a satisfactory outcome to people like that. So that the case in the example, the lady whose husband is sick, she's had no opportunity to find workarounds. In some sense, the provision by the association is her life belt, if you will. And it's what's important is that the law should produce a result that gets her the benefit that she was intended to have all the time. But under the current law, she might well be in difficulty because the right wasn't irrevocable from the outset. In fact, it was always revocable because the association could always cancel the provision in question. So I think that's where your default rule has to be a good working rule, because not everyone is in a position to get to workarounds to achieve what it is that the third party right could give them.
sticking with workarounds then, are you able to explain in a bit more detail how collateral warranties will work in practice, and why is that an improvement?
Yeah, well, it's all right if I... we have a diagram in our report, which, in order to stay within the 8 pages of your written evidence submission, we didn't include, but we could happily send it along to the committee. What this diagram shows is the bewildering maze that can emerge, usually at the end of construction projects. And the story there is that whatever the contractual framework, and the usual contractual framework will have a funder who is providing the money, who has a contract with a developer, and the developer has a contract with a builder, and the also probably a contract with professional advisors, architects, engineers, and so on. And the main contractor will have subcontracts with suppliers and people who are doing bits and pieces of the work on the great project. And out there in the distant future is a prospect that you will have someone who will actually buy this development, or perhaps more typically enter into leases, whether it's commercial, residential, or whatever. And basically the point is that collateral warranties are provided by the people who are doing the work, the professionals, the designers, the main contractor, the subcontractors, the suppliers. And they're issued in favour of, for example, the funder, who is way up at the top of the contractual tree, or for this future purchaser or lessee of the development in question. So that gives a good example, in fact, of the non-existent or unknown third party at the time of contracting. So what normally happens is that the project is completed, tenants are identified and so on, and the process of going out and getting collateral warranties begins. It's completely separate from and subsequent to, if you like, the successful completion of the project. And we've been given graphic stories by solicitors. Very often it's the young solicitors who are sent out into the pouring rain to go and knock on doors and get people to sign these collateral warranties. And sometimes people don't want to sign. And there are lots of difficulties. And the particular major difficulty is where, of course, the person you want to sign the warranty has gone out of business or has been taken over by someone else, or you know, the infinite range of possibilities. So it is a bit of a nightmare in just purely practical terms. And our thinking is that much of this could be removed if parties wrote into the contracts, which are still the sort of frame, the spine of the thing, third-party rights in favour of funders, in favour of purchasers, in favour of tenants, and so on. And it would be there from the start, and you wouldn't have to have this extraordinarily cumbersome and difficult process at the end. But again, we're not abolishing collateral warranties.
Does that provide any safeguard? You touched on, you know, things happen, people go out of business. Yes. Does that provide any extra safeguards?
Not really, no. Not against the going out of business.
Okay.
There might be some sort of protection against the party that's taken over, because the takeover might involve carrying on the liabilities of the previous business and so on. Or you can resurrect the previous business in order to make it liable.
Okay. Yeah. On liabilities, are you able to explain, just maybe for my benefit, what you mean by the black hole of non-liability in relation to, yes, to company groups?
Do you want me to try that one, Jill? Yes, yes. Well, it's a metaphor, obviously, a black hole, which was first used by a judge in about, I think, 1980 or so in a Scottish case. It's a Scottish invention. And the idea is essentially that a party suffers a loss as a result of a breach of contract, to which, however, that person suffering the loss is not a party. And the basic principle, starting principle in contract law is that you can only sue for a loss, sue for damages for a loss, if you are the victim of that loss. So it's a fairly obvious general principle, I think, probably right across the law. So if the loss happens to fall on a third person, tough. That's the basic, that's where there's a black hole. So you might have a situation, in other words, where if we've got a contract between A and B, A breaks the contract, B has no loss, and the third person instead has the loss. Now, how do such situations arise? I can see you want me to say. Construction is, again, the classic example. So, and it will typically involve groups of companies. So A and B, A is a contractor to do work, repair, maintain, build, whatever it might be, for B, who is a member of a company group. And during the course of the project, the course of this repair and maintenance contract, let's say, B, for entirely unconnected reasons, transfers the ownership of the property in question to another company in the group. Okay? So that when the breach works out in loss, the third person, the person to whom the property was transferred, is the one who suffers the loss but has no contract. The person who has the contract has suffered no loss. Does that make the position clear? Now, what you can do with third-party rights is provide in contract A and B that the other companies in the group will be entitled to enforce this contract. That's quite a common solution, as I understand it. But it does raise the difficulties which we've touched on about companies that don't exist and so on and so forth. But most of the time, that doesn't happen. You know, at the time the contract was made, they haven't thought about third-party rights at all. A and B are just carrying on, and then the company group takes a decision to move the property from B to C. Might even wind up B, who knows. Now, we don't think our bill provides an answer to that scenario, okay? It provides a solution which people could use at the time of drafting the contract, but if they haven't thought of it and there isn't a provision, then our bill doesn't apply. Our bill only applies to provisions in favour of third parties. So there's a black hole of non-liability, but we are addressing that further question of the black hole in a discussion paper which is currently in draft and out with an advisory group of solicitors because we have some ideas as to how the problem might be solved. But I think it would be premature for me to go into the detail of that, and it might cloud the issue as to this particular bill, but we have the problem in mind. And the idea of the black hole is simply that it's surely not quite right that someone should be able to breach a contract and escape liability because the liability, the loss, I beg your pardon, is being suffered by someone else for reasons which have nothing whatsoever to do with the contract position.
Thank you.
So we might bring you back another bill in 2 or 3 years' time.
Watch this space.
Dealing with that one.
Well, all that said, are there any other problems that we should be aware of, any other sort of practical issues that have come up from your investigation?
I think the major issue was the arbitration issue, which we didn't identify initially, but it became clear, really, in the course of considering the consultation that we'd received, consultation responses, that there was an issue which we then proceeded to address with fairly extensive consultation with the arbitration community in Scotland, which is not large but is quite good. it seemed to us that there was a need to make a provision there, and that is what we have done in the relevant section of the bill.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica. I appreciate the questions. George, if you would like to give
us... Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning. You've already given us examples of how construction may be a beneficiary in all this, but obviously there's oil and gas, financial services, IT and pension sectors are down in the report as areas that would actually benefit from this as well. Can you expand on what the benefits are for these sectors and how it will make a difference for them?
I think it's mainly because of the complexity of their kind of contract structure. You know, there's lots of subcontracting and lots of people who subcontract to subcontractors, and so lots of third-party rights are created in that way, and that they probably have the most to benefit. I mean, as well as particular sectors, there's also, I suppose, certain company structures will find this very beneficial, and that's the kind of group company structure that Hector's already spoken about, where there's a group of companies and there's the main company contracts for something, but if they haven't given third-party rights to the rest of the companies in their group, then they may not be able to benefit from something that went wrong. So there's large sectors, and I think that the structure of the company as well would find it beneficial. Do you want to add anything?
I could maybe add one or two things. I mean, you mentioned a number of specific sectors. Perhaps the oil and gas one is the one in which we've gathered most information and the position in the North Sea. And as Jill's rightly said, you have there two massively complicated structures of operation, lots and lots of subcontractors, and of course very high levels of risk, as we saw very clearly all these years ago with Piper Alpha, but these are ongoing things all the time. And basically what happens in the North Sea contracts is there's provision for indemnity, cross indemnities, knock for knock arrangements between the parties. And this is really designed for overall efficiency. And third-party rights are created. Third-party rights to these indemnities are created in the North Sea. But a fairly critical point is that these contracts are all made under English law. You have to say that from the point of view of Scots law, the North Sea was a missed the North Sea oil industry was a missed opportunity. And if you read the contracts that you see there, you see they are subject to English law, and you see that they invoke the Contracts Rights of Third Parties Act 1999 to establish these third-party indemnity agreements. So there was lost business there. And cases have tended to come into the Scottish courts only when you have extreme scenarios where the contracts don't apply, which was in fact what happened with the great Piper Alpha litigation at the beginning of this century. That did go into the Scottish courts because it was outside, all the liabilities we were talking about lay outside the scope of the contracts altogether. So I think that's a very good illustration of the fact that third-party rights are used. The problem that we have, I think, in Scotland is that people don't think our third-party rights system is going to do the business. I think so far as financial sector, pensions are a good example. You can think of, for instance, the process of nominating a person to take your pension in the event of your death in service and so on. That's a third-party right. Insurance is an example of third-party rights as well, where I take out a life assurance policy in favour of my spouse or my children. Motor insurance policies, where I take out a policy which covers other drivers of the vehicle which I'm insuring, and so on. So there's plenty of them. In fact, I exercise a third-party right, in a sense, myself last summer when I was allowed to drive my father's car when he wasn't feeling very well. And being careful lawyer, I checked his policy, and it did say other drivers with his permission. And he kindly permitted me, from his prostrate position, to drive him to hospital. So these are important examples, I think, of third-party rights that are created by contracts right now, very rarely tested in court as to the application of our Scots law rules. But in the key example for me is the North Sea oil, where the contracts are all under English law and refer to the 99 Act for the third party.
Can I follow up on something you said earlier on? You said that some of the companies, some of the individuals that would be involved in this, if you had an open checkbook, you could effectively get the workaround, get the answer that you wanted. Is construction not an example of this, where you do have so many subcontractors, where there might be smaller companies that don't have that access to legal information dealing with larger companies. Yep. So this is probably a perfect example where this would probably help out smaller businesses like that. Am I getting this right? Yeah. It's just so I can get it right.
Yes, no, I think that is right, provided that we're talking about these companies being in the position of third parties, claiming rights against others. It does give them some protection. I mean, I think it will be always the case that if you are a small organisation in business, that you will be under pressure. And this bill doesn't attempt to alleviate that pressure in any direct sense. But there may well be circumstances in which smaller organisations will be able to make use of these provisions in terms of rights for themselves. But it will depend on contracts that have perhaps not been drawn in great depth or detail, as distinct from the very sort of souped-up versions that you will get if you are a big contractor, say. You'll have also probably standard forms and so on that you can use. I might just say, perhaps, that there is with regard to the collateral warranty scenario, there is a draft contract available from the Scottish Building Contracts Committee, which incorporates provisions of the collateral warranty in the main contract and couches it in terms of the third party right. I went to a conference of the Scottish Building Contract Committee last November, I think it was, and I asked about the use of this. Did they know whether or not people were actually using that? And they didn't know, because it's not the job of the committee to know how its forms are used. They just put the forms out there, and it's up to people then to use them. But the anecdotal evidence which came back in that occasion was that collateral warranties were generally used because the funders preferred them. This is what the funders know. This is what was established in legal practice in England in the 1990s as a way around their lack at that time of a third-party rights. And the 1999 Act didn't change the minds of funders. We'll just go on doing what we're doing, was the attitude. And that applied equally to projects in Scotland. This is what we know, and we think it works. And that's fair enough.
Are there any other sectors other than the ones that I've kind of mentioned that this legislation could help or be beneficial for?
I don't think there's any sector that I would say definitely could never benefit. Any person, any sector which uses contracts and has any sort of complexity in its arrangements may well find that this bill provides an answer. It's very much a facility, I would say, and if you like, part of what will be necessary afterwards, the after-sales service, as we call it in the Commission, is to promote it to lawyers and to others. Scottish Buildings Contract Committee is one prime example. And say, this is what this does, this is what it could do for you. And I certainly see that as part of the job of the Scottish Law Commission. We've made this thing to be used, and we certainly don't want it to lie on the shelf, as it were, once it's through the legislative process.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks so much, George. And just on that point, I mean, how will this bill affect the use of collateral warranties in future?
Not affected at all. all I can really say is that solicitors, by and large, hate collateral warranties. I hope I'm not. Solicitors, by and large, hate collateral warranties because they're awkward and difficult things to gather in. And you're usually talking in any major project about a very large number of these things. It's not just, as in our simple diagram in the report, three or four collateral warranties. There may be scores of collateral warranties or even more in a major commercial development. So it's disliked from that point of view. There's a sort of time-consuming and perhaps almost sometimes self-defeating element in the collection. But what the solicitors will have to do, I think, if they want to eliminate the collateral warranty, is point to our bill as providing an efficient solution and persuade the funders and the developers and so on that this is actually a viable alternative. And to some extent, that will again be part of our job, as the Commission, and I would hope others too, who support the bill, to make the case and say this would be a better solution to this particular problem.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I just take you back to English statute rules and other jurisdictions? And they've been in existence since 1999, statute rules and third-party rights. Can you provide further information on the impact of this legislation? I know you spoke about the North Sea oil industry. Mm-hmm. Do you have other examples?
I think, unfortunately, there isn't a lot of research or analysis out there about how effective the 1999 Act has been in changing the way that people are treating third-party rights. There's been some articles written, and they certainly all talk about there being a change. I think it's been a fairly slow change. There's still the issue about collateral warranties being familiar for people, so they stick with what they know. There's also a lot of evidence out there through various articles that Scots lawyers are using the 1999 Act. And I suppose the one difference is that our starting points are different. So when the 1999 Act came into force in England and Wales, they didn't have third-party rights before that. So it was quite a fundamental change in their law. That's not going to be the case here in Scotland. We had third-party rights, they just didn't work very well, or they're not working very well. So this wouldn't be such a significant step for people. It would just be an improvement to what there is. So you would imagine that there might be a greater readiness to throw themselves into third-party rights and use them more than the experience down in England and Wales. But it seems to be that they are being used and people are getting more familiar with them, but there are still other options that people are using as well. Do you think that's fair? Yeah.
Perhaps another example would be helpful, which is, again, is in our report. One of the things we discovered was that Network Rail, in its contracts with the railway companies, what I think they call them station access agreements and track access agreements, these all provide for third-party rights in favour of, south of the border, the UK government, and north of the border for Scottish ministers to enforce these contracts. Why did that happen? And the answer is, of course, that Network Rail's predecessor, Railtrack, which may be a name that conjures up certain images, around about 2001, two was it? I can't remember the year, crashed and burned. Network Rail replaced it. But what the crashing and burning of Railtrack exposed was, how are we going to get these agreements, keep them going? So the 1999 Act, south of the border, was a huge boon, and all you had to do was write in that the UK government has third-party rights to enforce these contracts against the railway companies. And the contracts can then go on, regardless of what happens to Network Rail, this new company. In Scotland, there was a slight difficulty, because whereas in the English context, you'd simply say they have the rights under the 1999 Act, in Scotland, the contract had to refer to jus quaesitum tertio and say it's all irrevocable. A very distinguished law firm worked very, very hard to produce a clause. When we have this bill in place, it will be very simple to simply refer to it under its statute short title and say the Scottish government, the Scottish ministers have these rights. As far as experience in England is concerned, I think you're speaking with Professor Hugh Beale next week, who has really carried out the only piece of research that I know of as to the actual use of the English Act. That was published about 2010. And it's very interesting because he covers a wide range of examples. And his research was based on contacting friends and other contacts in the legal profession and asking them, how do you use the 99 Act? And he was surprised to find that use of it was increasing gently. You know, lawyers don't like to do anything in a great rush. Gently, things were moving forward. And our own researches in Scotland tended to confirm that. But we don't expect an instant transformation. And in particular, in the construction context, as I say, I think the key there is really the attitude of funders. Funders don't want change to the arrangements that seem to work, and that will probably be a dominant factor for some time to come.
Thank you. You touched just a little on arbitration. Would you want to expand on the need for Scottish arbitration legislation to deal expressly with third-party rights? Would you like to discuss that further?
Yeah, shall I give that one a go, Jill? Yes, well, the starting point is, for Scotland, the Arbitration Act of 2010, which is a very successful act of this Parliament. Modernised arbitration designed to bring business into Scotland, and it is being used slowly, gently, but there is plenty of evidence that the Act is successful. What the Act doesn't do, however, is make provision for third parties to have rights to join arbitrations or to invoke arbitration clauses. In a sense, it's not surprising that that should be so. But what the English did in 1999 was to include a provision ultimately in their Act. Because they had been approached by the arbitration community in London and said this Act would be more useful already if it included provisions about arbitration in it. And essentially what happened in England, because this all really took place after the Law Commission there had reported on this and decided they couldn't do anything, what happened there was that the relevant commissioner worked together with arbitration industry to produce solutions to two problems, which we can take it that the arbitration community thought were real issues or potential issues for arbitration. Now, we try to give some examples of this in our handout or in our submission. Example four is the first case and is a relatively easy case, really. What it recognises is, what the relevant provision recognises in the 99 Act and it also similarly in our present bill, is a situation where the contracting parties create a third party right, let's say to payment or performance of some kind, supply of goods or whatever it might be. But they make that third-party right dependent on enforcement by arbitration. It will usually be in some sort of general clause in the contract. All disputes arising from this contract or this agreement will be subject to arbitration. People want to avoid the courts, and the law allows them to do that by arbitration clauses. And the question really is, given that the Arbitration Act in England, as is in Scotland, doesn't allow third parties to join, how can that clause work? And so the solution that was provided for in the English Act and is provided for in our bill is that where you have a third party right, a substantive third party right, as we sometimes call it, subject to arbitral enforcement, that is the enforcement. It's perfectly consistent with the policy of third-party rights to say third-party rights can be conditional. If the conditional is arbitral enforcement, then that third party should be allowed to submit any dispute or claim it has to an arbitration. Okay, so that, I think that's an easy example. I hope it's an easy example. There's no real difficulty about that. The second case is more tricky. In essence, this is about claims by or against the third party which lie outside the contract altogether. Okay, Again, perhaps the simplest way is through the example on the handouts, example 5, which was suggested to us, let me add, by the Family Law Arbitration Group Scotland, which is a body of family law practitioners who want to promote the use of arbitration in family disputes. I think largely, again, in the interests of less well-off clients. And in particular, the case that was put to us is cohabitants who've entered into what are called pre-purchase agreements. They have definitely decided they do not want to get married or enter a civil partnership, if that is what they just wish to cohabit, but they wish to buy a house together. That's the scenario. Perfectly common for there to be arbitration provision, apparently, in such transactions are called pre-purchase agreements. And the point really is that if the relationship breaks up, breaks down, the parties will resolve the dispute about the proceeds of the sale of the house by way of arbitration rather than going through the court. Great advantage too, privacy. arbitration is essentially a private process. What happens in court is a public process. So there are certain win-wins. The scenario which we developed out of that particular case was one based on actually my own personal experience, not as a party, but as a seller to persons who couldn't afford the price without the assistance, the financial assistance of a relative. And so when we transferred our house to these people, we also included in the title the third-party relative who had funded or supported the acquisition of the property. So they became a joint owner with the happy couple. And of course, what could happen, it didn't happen in our case, but what could happen is that you have a breakdown of the relationship and the third party, the relative, is involved. Are you with me? But their involvement is not based on anything that's said in the contract. The contract, the pre-purchase agreement, doesn't say anything about them. But what they have is an independent right of property. They share in the property that belongs to these now two disputing persons. And so what the second provision in arbitration allows is a person who is asserting a right which is relevant to a dispute which is otherwise being arbitrated between other parties, the cohabitants in this case, to join that arbitration and have their claim considered in that context. Why do this? Well, the basic point is this, that if, as under the present law, the funding relative can't join the arbitration because they're a third party to it, they have to go to court in order to establish. And there is a risk in that scenario that the arbitration will decide one thing about how the proceeds of the sale of the house are to be distributed, and the court will decide another. It makes sense for all issues relative to this to be considered in one forum, in one tribunal. And the obvious forum is the arbitration. So what we're providing there is for a third party to be able to join an arbitration between two others, even though they don't have a third party right in the substantive sense that's available in our first example. But their dispute, their claim, is nonetheless relevant to the matter that is being arbitrated between the arbitrating parties. So what I understand from the English experience was that no one could figure an example of this sort. And there has never been a case decided under it in England. We are quite proud of this example that we have thought of, because it does actually seem to us to be a real example. It's a scenario we know could occur. And we know that arbitration is being used, particularly between cohabitants, as a way of resolving disputes when their relationship breaks down. And we know that there are these third-party funders who frequently take title along with their cohabitants, and the relationship breakdown may involve them as well, as we try to say in our hypothetical example on the submission, the written submission. So we think we've advanced one step beyond where the English were in recognising. Here is a practical example of where this provision might work or be useful. And we'll just have to see how that goes once it's out there.
Given your fertile mind, would there be areas in agricultural law and Scots law, particularly with regard to limited partnerships, where arbitration might be used there to settle any number of imaginable and unimaginable difficulties that arise?
I think the agricultural sector is an area where undoubtedly arbitration is used and can be very effective in its use. I haven't been able to think of an example which might involve a third party in that sense. In other words, the arbitration would just simply take place under the 2010 Act in Scotland, and presumably there are provisions in the Agricultural Holdings Act, I think, aren't there, statutory arbitrations? Not completely sure about that, but
Okay, thank you very much. Finally, can I just ask if about the policy memorandum, which states that the bill will encourage greater use of Scots law, which is similar to one of the intended objectives of the Legal Writings Counterparts and Deliveries Scotland Act 2015. And we're just wondering if the delivery of, indeed, that Counterparts and Delivery, the Legal Writings Act, has led to the greater use of Scots law as trailed and promised at the time?
Short answer, probably yes. We did do a kind of survey of probably the bigger legal firms in Scotland, ones that were likely to have, you know, lots of departments that deal with lots of property leases, commercial transactions. And they asked around within their own organisations, and we got back very positive comments about that piece of legislation. And the sorts of comments were, you know, it's made the decision to use Scots law easier, and certainly for international transactions and for things that were tight on time, it has been a boon. So, yes, I think it wasn't a kind of formal, statistical, analytical follow-up on that Act, which really has only been in force now for 18 months. So it's still relatively early days. But broadly speaking, I think, yes, there has been an uptake and an improvement, and people think that that will continue. So we'd be hopeful that this bill would have the same sort of impact.
And thereby benefit Scottish legal fraternity, so to speak, in that regard, in terms of bringing work to Scots law.
Yep.
Yes. Excellent. Well, thank you very much. Are there any other questions that anyone wishes to add or to ask when we have this distinguished panel in front of us or not? Right. Well, can I close by thanking you all for taking the time to come and talk to us today and give us your very elegant evidence, for which we are very grateful. And we will be in further touch, I dare say. But in the meantime, thank you very much for taking the trouble to come and be with us today. Thank you. I'll suspend the meeting just for a second to allow our witnesses to depart. carefully and just remember that we are going. So we now move on to agenda item 4, which is Seatbelts and School Transport Scotland Bill, and the consideration of the delegated powers within the Seatbelts on School Transport Scotland Bill. And this bill confers one power to make subordinate legislation upon the Scottish ministers. It suggested that we could be content with this power. So, can I invite the committee to agree that it is content with the one power in the bill and to prepare a stage one report in this regard?
Content.
Thanks very much. I now move the meeting back into private.